Today we talk about that gastritis. Gastritis means, you know, that the term itself self-explanation, that gastritis means that stomach, and the itis means the inflammation, means inflammation of stomach. But the whole stomach is not inflamed, but the gastritis means when the inner line of the stomach means that gastric mucosa is inflamed, then that is termed as gastritis. So there is so many kind of the pathophysiologies are occurred in the gastritis. So on the basis of that pathophysiologies, there is various kind of gastritis has been observed. So we just discuss one by one. First, the type A gastritis. Type A gastritis is it's an autoimmune disorder. Autoimmune disorder means when our immune system start working against us. Means the cells, the antibodies are developed in our body, which are antibody start harming our own tissue. So here the antibodies are developed, which is starting damages the parietal cells of the stomach. You know, the parietal cells in the stomach, there is basic three type of the cells. Important cells are there in the stomach, that is these parietal cells, chief cells, and the endocrine cells. So here they are starting damaging the parietal cells. So due to damaging of these parietal cells, that hydrochloric acid secreted in the stomach is not secreted properly, because the cells which are secreted, which are responsible for the secretions of that hydrochloric acid, that are damaged by our own antibodies. So that leads to the hypochlorhydria, and ultimately achlorhydria, means no hydrochloric acid. So in the long term effect of this type of the pathophysiology, this type of the autoimmune gastritis, the long term effect is that due to the damage of the parietal cells, which secrete the intrinsic factor which is responsible for the absorption of the vitamin B12, it not secreted properly, so that patients is unable to absorb the vitamin B12, that may ultimately lead to the depression of that RBC productions, that causes the pernicious anemia. In the long term, due to these hypochlorhydria or achlorhydria conditions, there is maybe some changes occurs, and the adenocarcinoma may be developed in the stomach. Okay, so that type A gastritis is the gastritis develops due to the autoimmune conditions, means our own body develops the antibodies against the parietal cells of the stomach, so they start damaging the cells, and this happen that all the symptoms of the gastritis occurs. Along with the long term, there is a development of the chronic pernicious anemia. Second gastritis is the type B gastritis. This is the most common type of the gastritis which is found, and the causative factor behind this is that is the infection of the H. pylori. H. pylori means the Helicobacter pylori is a bacteria which after infection in the stomach is residue in the infection in the stomach lining, and it start the hypersecretions of that gastritis, hypergastrinemia. So the pathology is developed as the Helicobacter organism. The Helicobacter organism has ability to hydrolyze the urea, which is present in our body, means that blood, that so that this organism easily hydrolyze the urea, so that urea with the hydrolysis or hydrolysis of the urea, there is development of the ammonia. So that ammonia has a very high alkali nature. So with the high alkali nature, it reduces the acidic environment of the stomach is disturbed and it becomes alkali. So with this and when the stomach environment become alkali, the gastrin, the G cells presence in the stomach line, G cells, they start secreting more gastrin, so that more hydrochloric acids and more gastric juice is secreted. So that leads to the feedback mechanism and development of that hyper secretions of the gastric juices, that called the hyperchlorhydria, and that produces that excessive gastric acid secretions, damage the gastric mucosa, and this also damage that we discussed in the last lecture, the gastric mucus barrier. So this gastric mucus barrier is damaged completely, so that the inner line of the mucosa comes directly in the contact of the gastric acid. So that gastric acid start damaging this gastric inner lining of that stomach, and that is cause the inflammation in that lining, so that the gastritis happens. In the long term, the gastric mucosa may have the ulcers, or maybe the tends to bleed, and may have some changes, so that metaplasia occurs, so that carcinoma may be developed. So the most common cause of the gastric carcinoma is that infection of the H. pylori, and the most common cause of the peptic ulcer is also the infection of the H. pylori. So it's a very common things that the type B gastritis is the most common type of the gastritis which occurs. So the infections of the H. pylori is responsible for that production of the type B gastritis. So here the important thing is that if you found a patient having chronic history of the gastritis, then you may suspect that H. pylori infections and go further to diagnose it. So diagnosis based on its function of the urea. There is a urease kit is there, so that it is with the help of urease kit, it can be diagnosed that the excessive urea ammonia in the stomach, it means there is a presence of the H. pylori. And sometime with the endoscopy, it can be demonstrated, this H. pylori can be demonstrated in the mucus line, gastric lining, or that biopsy may be also, with the biopsy it may be also seen that H. pylori, presence of the H. pylori. So that's how you can confirm that infection of the H. pylori and type B gastritis. Next, that is reflex gastritis. So reflex gastritis is developed usually that enterogastric reflex. Entero means that the reflection of the alkali material, means that in the duodenum, you know, that in the stomach there is acidic environment, and since the beyond that stomach, from the duodenum, it's gastric, it's alkali environment. So when there is the any reflex of the any alkali material from that of the food, the chylus, and the from that duodenum to the stomach, that causes the changes in the environment of that acidic environment, changing in the environment of the stomachs, that leads to the hyper secretions of that hydrochloric acid, and that causes the hyperchlorhydria, and that causes that gastritis, that is called the reflex gastritis. It is more common in the patients who already has gone under any kind of gastric surgery, or the cholecystectomy. You know the cholecystectomy, what they do? The cholecystectomy is mean they remove the gallbladder, so there is no reservoir of the bile. So bile is always secreted in the liver, and it's reserved in the gallbladder. And when somebody take the food, and when the food comes from the duodenum, then the bile is released and starting the digestion. But if somebody has the remove the gallbladder, and so that when the bile is secreted in the liver, and from the liver it directly comes into the duodenum. So it sometimes it happens that there is a no requirement of the bile, but still the bile is coming from the liver to the duodenum, and that excessive bile may reflux back into the stomach. That causes the reflux gastritis. So some bile chelating agents and the prokinetic drugs are useful in the treatment if there is a reflux gastritis you have diagnosed. And prokinetics are the drug which increase the motility of that alimentary canal. So with the motility increase, peristaltic movement, if bile is collected in the duodenum, so it will not reverse back into the stomach, but with the effect of that peristaltic movement, it goes into the jejunum as well as in the ileum. Means it move forward, so it prevents the reflux gastritis. Next one, the erosive gastritis. Erosive gastritis is there which develops due to the any kind of that the food or any kind of the chemical agents, the drugs which disturb the mucosal barrier, gastric mucosal barrier, as well as irritates the gastric mucosa, and so that it there is a injury of that gastric line, that gastric mucosa, and cause the inflammations of the gastric mucosa. That's called the gastritis. So you know the food means high excessive chilies, and that excessive acidic or acidic alkali food, whatever food which can irritate the gastric mucosa. The most common cause of the erosive gastritis is nowadays the NSAIDs and the alcohols. NSAIDs, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, means the drugs used for the painkiller, non-opioid painkiller drugs, are these are the very most common cause for the erosive gastritis, because these along with this irritation of the gastric mucosa, they inhibits the COX-1 productions. So this is the enzyme which is which secretes by the stomach lining to for the protection of that stomach. There is these prostaglandins or the anti-inflammatory agents are secreted by the stomach lining to reduce the inflammation of the gastric mucosa. It inhibits the secretion of the COX-1, so that causes the erosions in the gastric line, and this causes the erosive gastritis. Next one, the stress gastritis. Stress is stress means not that exactly the mental stress. Stress means when the body goes into the stress. What means of the body goes into the stress? It means the body is going to the severe illness or the severe injury. Body is under tension. It's under tension means body is that complete metabolism is slowing, disturbed, or there is the serious illness causing the long term hypotension. So that causes the injury of that gastric line, gastric mucosa. We already had discussed that gastric mucosa is the most sensitive mucosa in our body. The cells of the gastric mucosa easily goes into the hypoxia. Means if a person is going into the hypotension, then the first effect of that hypoxia is seen on that gastric mucosa, and the gastric mucosa is going to the hypoperfusion and tends to damage of these lines. So these kind of the stress gastritis is seen in the patients who are severely ill or remain hypotensive for a very long time, having a grievous injury. So usually this type of gastritis is not a means not has not very much features, but until it tends to bleed or having the ulcerations. So that's why if any patient is severely ill or having hypotensive and admitted, so that's why there is a protocol that they in the hospital, you have seen that when the patient is admitted in the hospitals, they and a severely ill patient, they start the PPIs, proton pump inhibitors, that pantoprazole, rabeprazole, and the H2 blocker drugs, so that they reduces that gastric acid secretions, which prevents the damage of that gastric mucosa and prevents the ulceration as well as the bleeding. So this is the kind of the stress gastritis which is seen in the burn patients or the any other patients which are severely ill and hospitalized. That's why this PPIs and H2 blockers are used to avoid this stress gastritis, along with this to improve the perfusion in the body to start the resuscitations early to prevent this stress gastritis. Next is the miniaturized disease. So miniaturized disease, it is also having the kind of that inflammation in the gastric mucosa. So this is the abnormal conditions, very very unusual and rare condition where there is the hypertrophy of these gastric mucosal folds. So you know our stomach lining has the gastric mucosal folds. So there is that excessive gross hypertrophy of this mucosal folds and excessive production of the mucus. This causes the hypochlorhydria. So due to the effect of the hypochlorhydria, there is again the feedback mechanism, again hypersecretions of that gastrin hormone and other again secretions of that more and more gastric acids that causes the damage of the gastric mucosa. And this is the pre-malignant conditions. It's very rare conditions. Pre-malignant conditions means patients with the abnormal excessive gross hypertrophy of the gastric mucosal folds may have chances to develop to the that malignancy. So the conditions appear due to the over expression of transforming growth factors. So this is the growth factor which is secreted in the time of the wound healing in the inflammatory phase to cope up the inflammations, start inflammations and start the healing process. So here the excessive secretions of that TGF alpha, there is a overproduction of that gastric mucosal folds that causes the hypochlorhydria. So this is the very rare conditions. Next is the lymphatic gastritis, where the macrophages and the lymphatic cells move towards through the body towards the gastric mucosa, and because these are the inflammatory cells, so when there is a excessive presence of the T cells lymphocytes in the mucosa, that's called the gastritis, and due to the presence of this lymphatic cells, it is called the lymphatic gastritis. So this may be the probably associated by H. pylori infection, because the infection of the H. pylori may invites the inflammatory cells in our body to come there to act against that H. pylori. That's why these overcoming of that the lymphatic cells may also produce that gastritis, the inflammation of the gastric mucosa. So that is the lymphatic gastritis. And other type of gastritis is also there, means when some miscellaneous, some any kind of the organisms or the any kind of that disease producing pathogens may cause, means some other non-specific organism are also there which may also cause the gastritis. then some eosinophilic due to that allergic conditions, there may be gastritis, may be there some the tuberculosis infections, the granulomatous gastritis may be issues, may be there due to the Crohn's disease or some other bacterial or viral gastritis are also there. Next come to the clinical features. What are the clinical features which are associated in the inflammation of the gastric mucosa? First is the pain in abdomen, and usually this pain occurs in the upper abdomen, epigastrium. So pain in the epigastrium, nausea, bloating, vomiting, fever in the severe conditions, anorexia, and anemia may also be there. So these are the clinical features which may found in a patient's, and then you can suspect it may be the gastritis. Then you start rule out the what is the cause, that is that you can rule out with this the history taking, the examinations, and then next to that after the investigations. So investigation to diagnose, the confirm the diagnosis is to first to with the history rule out which kind of the gastritis is there. Then the best diagnostic tool is that endoscopy. With the endoscopy you can directly see that the gastric mucosa. You can take the biopsy so that you can rule out the what are the changes occurs at the histological level. So you can easily identify the which kind of that gastritis is there. So treatments is always depends on the which type of gastritis is there. Type A, type B, stress, or erosive, or reflex, or lymphatics, or the which kind of gastritis is there. So you have to treat the patient accordingly. If the most common cause of this gastritis is the H. pylori infections. So that's why if you suspect that is due to the H. pylori infections, then H. pylori eradication therapy you have to do. Along with this PPI, proton pump inhibitors, H2 blockers, antacids. And if other any underlying cause is there, then you have to just treat that conditions. And usually only gastritis, the surgery is not advised. But in few conditions, if just like in meningitis disease, surgery is the only options. And if the patient has developed that enough amount of that ulcers, or there is excessive bleeding, the perforation is there, in that conditions, that surgical management may be required. So we will discuss surgical management in the peptic ulcers. The same surgical management is also advised here. So H. pylori eradication therapy includes that various too many regimens are there, but the most common regimens which is most effective also, that is triple drug therapy. So triple drug therapy includes that clarithromycin, metronidazole, and PPIs. So these are the combination of the drugs: clarithromycin, metronidazole, PPI, or amoxicillin, clarithromycin, PPI, amoxicillin, metronidazole, and PPI. PPI is always included in the kit. And some others that quadruple therapy are also there, means where that bismuth is also included in this therapy, along with this clarithromycin or amoxicillin or this metronidazole or the tinidazole. You can use these drugs. So I'm not going to very much detail in the pharmacology of these drugs, because you can treat these conditions with us as being Ayurvedic BMS students. We can treat this gastritis conditions with our Ayurvedic drugs also. So we just stop here. Now anybody has any question, then we can discuss this. Next, from tomorrow we start the peptic ulcers. So this gastritis topic ends here. So if anybody has any question, then